My name's Sarah Turner. I'm Deputy Director for Research at the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome you all here today on behalf of myself and the co-conveners of this symposium, Lucy Steeds from the University of the Arts London, who's here at the front in a fetching lime green, so you can see her, and Hammad Nasar, who is Senior Research Fellow at the Paul Mellon Centre and Executive Director of the Stuart Hall Foundation. Our symposium is entitled The LYC Museum and Art Gallery, and the Museum as Practice. And today it's Manchester Art Gallery, which is our site of practice. And I want to begin by thanking Manchester Art Gallery for hosting this event and being such generous collaborators and colleagues in welcoming us and making today happen. And I particularly want to thank Kate Jessen, Natasha Howes, Victoria Wilson, and Alistair Hudson, and all the team, the technical staff, who've helped us pull off this symposium. The LYC Museum was, by all accounts, a very special place. It was a site of collaboration, creativity, and conversation, and we want to take that spirit today and use it as a framework for our discussions. Today's symposium has been made possible through a series of collaborations with Manchester Art Gallery, with UAL, with the University of Manchester, and particularly our colleague who's just sitting down, David Butler, the Paul Mellon Centre, and I want to thank Tom Knowles. Many of you will have had email correspondence with him, and he's really managed the logistics and administration of the symposium. To all our speakers, chairs, and the artists who activated the Speech Acts exhibition in incredible ways last night. And for those of you who could join us yesterday evening, I'm sure you'll agree that it was quite a wonderful, again, collaborative, collegial experience to go around the exhibition with Hammad and Kate and hear their ideas, but have these amazing moments of punctuation to really think in new ways about the exhibition. Exhibitions in many ways are not just the endpoints of projects, so much incredible work goes into them and getting them ready, but they're really launch pads, springboards for further thinking and research, and hopefully provoking and prompting new thinking, new narratives and new ways of practice. Speech Acts does just that. There's an evocation, a stylized reconstruction of the LYC Museum in the exhibition. And we wanted to take that as an opportunity to reconsider the histories and the legacies of Lee Wan Chau and the LYC Museum, re-examining it as a vehicle for shaping collective stories and cultivating communities. And I think at this moment it feels particularly urgent to do that, to take Lee Wan Chau's inspiration to think across borders whilst also creating vibrant local communities. The Speech Act exhibition is a node within a number of research projects. It came out of the Black Artists and Modernism project at UAL, which was spearheaded by the artist Sonia Boyce, and it's also connected to the London Asia research project that Hammad and I co-convene at the Paul Mellon Centre. And both those projects are generating questions about the established narratives of British art, calling for those art histories to account for the presence and practice of Black and Asian artists within the histories of the art world in Britain. So today's symposium has been inspired by those questions and collaborations. And across the rest of today, I think we're all going to be challenged to be inspired and be informed by our speakers, many of whom have travelled significant distances to be with us. And I want to thank them and our respondents for giving so generously and sharing their work and their time with us today. And for all of you for coming as well. You are part of this collaborative research project and programme of thinking together, inspired by an exhibition. I want us to think about our sessions with their trios, the two papers and the respondents, as something of an LYC three-way ping pong table. And we're going to have a playful bouncing of ideas, I think, between us all. And there'll be plenty of breaks within the programme. And we encourage you to go and explore the exhibition in those, to watch Helen Pett's amazing film, and to share ideas amongst yourselves. And now I'm going to hand over to my collaborator and master ping pong player, Hammad Nasar.
Thank you, Sarah. And I think there will be bats and balls at the table upstairs today. I'm going to start very briefly with a couple more thanks. Firstly, just acknowledge Christopher Payne. I did see him from the University of Manchester, who's very much part of the team in putting together the symposium. And also thank the many, many people who made not just the exhibition, but particularly this paper possible. Nick Sawyer, the team at the Taipei Fine Art Museum, who were so generous in sharing their research. Mei-Ching Fang, Wei Yu, Kai-Wei Wang, and Jeanette Martin and Stella Hawkyard at the John Ryden's Library. And last but not least, Sarah Turner for her valuable feedback on an earlier version of this paper that, as I see around, maybe I think only three of you have suffered before, so apologies for that, because you will see some familiar images, but I will make a start. Now, in the last few years, the work of Chinese-born artist Li Wenxie, 1929-94, has featured in two very different exhibitions on two continents in two national institutions that could both claim him as their own. In Taiwan, the Taipei Fine Art Museum did just that, with a posthumous retrospective that positioned him as the father of conceptual and abstract art in Taiwan. It traced his practice over 5 years, over five decades, rather. In Britain, however, Li remains largely unrecognized. Though it was his home from 1966 until his death in 1994, his work was a minor presence in Tate Britain's Migrations, Journeys into British Art in 2012, and a recent display at Tate Modern was only slightly more expansive. His work was entirely absent from the Tate Britain exhibition Conceptual Art in Britain 1964 to 1979, and is unaccounted for in the generally circulating institutional and academic histories of art in Britain. Now, this is at least partly due to this distinctive genealogy of Li's work that resists attempts to slot it into a singular label. He drew liberally from modernist, Zen, Buddhist, and Taoist practices to explore ideas of space, life, and time. The initial vehicle for his exploration was the point, the origin and end of creation that was so beautifully evoked in two of the performances yesterday, both from Madeleine Huicas and Cara C, and Bettina Fung. Originally a spot of color or a mark in monochromatic paintings and reliefs, it eventually took the form of magnetized objects, or toys, as Li's called them, inviting active audience participation. Now, this sense of play and participation was taking new forms by the time of his Golden Moon show, 1969, at the Listen Gallery. The retrospective at the Taipei Fine Art Museum and a growing engagement with artists associated with Signals Gallery has sparked new interest in Li's work, with a clutch of recent exhibitions in London and Taipei. But despite this more recent interest, art history is yet to seriously engage with arguably his most important work, the remarkable space he founded in the Cumbrian countryside. The LYC Museum and Art Gallery was located in the village of Banks, astride Hadrian's Wall. Li Wenxie's initials gave the museum its name, LYC. And between 1972 and 83, the museum showcased the work of more than 320 artists, from local figures, Andy Christian, Susie Honor, to totemic national artists such as Paul Nash and Barbara Hepworth, and contemporary artists now of international renown, so Leisha Clark or Andy Goldsworthy, but then barely known in Britain. You'll recognize this picture from yesterday. So Li standing in front of a window designed and produced by a young David Nash. Now, the networks and practices that the LYC Museum enabled and enriched have yet to be studied widely. For example, his friendship with the concrete poet and Benedictine monk, Don Sylvester Huidard, or the pioneering sound artist Delia Derbyshire, Lee's assistant and briefly partner at the LYC Museum in 1976 and 77. Friendships and the expanded notions of infrastructure they often become part of are growing areas of recent scholarship that can productively illuminate any consideration of the LYC. And I'll particularly like to point to Leela Gandhi's charting of the politics of friendship in her book, Effective Communities. And in her recent essay, Infrastructure as Form, Karen Zitzewitz argues for the need for us not to separate the analysis of art from the activities from which they emerge. To do so, she contends, would attribute artistic production exclusively to the artist and ignore how ably a networked art infrastructure distributes agency among its elements. I would argue that the LYC Museum is an exemplary site from which to explore both these formulations, the question of how friendships inform shared practices, generate work, and socialize narrative, and how the LYC itself functions as a kind of infrastructure. As Sarah mentioned, the LYC Museum has been evoked in a stylized reconstruction and is very much at the heart of the exhibition that hopefully most of you have seen upstairs. Now, this paper is a series of notes and speculations towards a larger collective project of which this symposium is an important part. It explores these ideas of friendship and, to a lesser extent, infrastructure through the lens of three works in the Speech Acts exhibition. All three works are participatory and have, to a different extent, collective authorship and a relationship with me. It attempts to read the traces of friendships in objects and situations. The principal artwork is the LYC Museum and Art Gallery itself. The second is the video work, Point in Time, by Madeleine Huykas, that you can see, and Elsa Stensfield, that features Lee as a participant, and you can see in the exhibition upstairs. The third and final example is the newly commissioned film, Space and Freedom, by Helen Petz, that I hope you will get the chance to see over lunchtime today. Now, the LYC Museum has often been positioned as Lee sacrificing his own practice while he gave his, and I quote, attention to others. But I would like to place the LYC Museum in an artistic trajectory that saw Lee moving from static objects to the production of work that invited participation from audiences to animate the work. Now, the museum started life as a set of dilapidated farm buildings that Lee acquired from his friend and neighbor, the painter Winifred Nicholson. The LYC Museum ran an exhibition program, as we've already discussed, of prodigious range and eclecticism. It reflected Lee's circuitous cosmopolitanism and his commitment to art as a mode of experimentation. For Lee was also a poet, a designer-maker, and a curator of art and social interaction. Born in Guangxi, China, Lee moved to Taiwan in 49, where he was part of the Ton Fan group of artists, experimenting with abstraction. In 62, he moved to Bologna, where he was associated with the Punto group of artists. An invitation to show at the Signals Gallery from David Madala brings him to London in 1966. There, he had multiple solo and group exhibitions at the Listen Gallery between 67 and 70, showing alongside artists such as Ken Cox, Mira Shendel, Ian Hamilton Finlay, and Derek Jarman. But London's regard for Lee was not wholly reciprocated. A trip to his friend Nick Sawyer's family house in Cumbria, Boothby, for Christmas in 1967 saw him settle in nearby Bankside, opening the LYC Museum in 1972. The museum consumed Lee. He built it himself, undertaking all building, plumbing, electrical work. It hosted four new exhibitions a month, each accompanied by a catalogue that he designed and printed. Apart from galleries, the LYC Museum had an arts room a library, a performance space, a printing press, a communal kitchen, and a garden. It hosted rug-making workshops. Children played in its courtyard. It was an open space for the multiple possibilities of art. The artist Sheila Wakely, whose work is also in our little LYC hut upstairs, exhibited at the LYC in 1979 and saw the museum very much as a work of his. It was an example of social practice before such a thing was named and tamed. And after its closure in 83, it became the site of Lee's experimentation with hand-tinted photographs. Now, Lee's establishment of the LYC Museum in 72 has been called an impulsive, intuitive move. But I read the LYC's formulation as a central progression of the experimentation that Lee was engaged in during his time at Boothby, 67 to 71. Now, Boothby was Sawyer's stepfather's family house. Wilfred Roberts was a farmer turned radical liberal politician who Sawyer recounts as, and I quote, playing chess with Wyndham Lewis, getting drunk with Dylan Thomas, and dining out with Stalin. Robert's eldest sister was Winifred Nicholson. And Wilfred and Winifred were grandchildren of George Howard, the 9th Earl of Carlisle, and a painter, as his obituary notes, of pre-Raphaelite tendencies, and a younger member of the circle of William Morris and Burne Jones. So Boothby was the repository of unusual artistic treasures. A Bomberg hung in Sawyer's bedroom. Sawyer recounts thumbing through hand-painted William Blake manuscript as a child and being surrounded by artworks by Moore, Rossetti, and of course, Winifred Nicholson. Now, Nicholson moved from Paris to Boothby early during the Second World War and made it her Cumbrian base for the next 20 years. She painted views from the house as well as its interiors. And on arriving at Boothby in Christmas in 67, Lee struck a friendship with Wilfred and Kate Roberts and was offered a large studio room in Boothby at nominal rent, the very room previously occupied by Winifred Nicholson. And those very views also inspired Lee and found voice in his poetry. And I'd sort of just particularly draw attention to the sort of the bold bit. So I like Brampton for its made me to love this world again. It sort of highlights what Lee had spoken about earlier of coming to Cumbria in search of space and freedom, and managed to establish a livelihood through gardening, painting, decorating, which allowed him to experiment in his studio at Boothby without the need to sell to survive. And the two self-organized exhibitions he held in Boothby evidence a growing interest in exhibiting environmental and participatory works. The first was held in October 68, the second in June 69. So both before the Listen Gallery show that I showed you an image of earlier. Now, Richard DeMarco's digital archive offers a set of installation shots of the first Boothby exhibition. The photos show elaborate arrangements of Lee's circular disc, many with movable magnetic points. Plastic sheets hung from the ceiling with circular holes cut in them, delineating microenvironments within the larger space. You can see these wall hangings at the back of also Lee's work. And most curiously, an arrangement of Lee's geometric points on a tufted circular rug. Now, several photographs show Lee encouraging his visitors to interact directly with the work. He also installed a web-like installation with washing lines strung across the trees in the courtyard of Boothby. And one important trace of these exhibitions at Boothby is a tablecloth that served as Lee's visitor's book. And if you examine some of the names there, Audrey Barker, E.J. Hooper, Winifred Nicholson, any one of these names opens up trajectories that are vast. One of those trajectories, of course, leads to a little-known but important exhibition called Popa at MoMA, Pioneers of Part Art, or Participatory Art, at the Museum of Modern Art, Oxford, in 71. Alongside Lee, it featured Leisha Clark, John Duggar, David Medalla, Helio Tissica, and Graham Stevens. And it reached notoriety for when a jolly young Oxford crowd took the Part Art Manifesto literally. And as Hilary Flo quotes, everything was getting smashed. Two of the artists who were there for the opening, Medalla and Duggar, withdrew their work. Lee was happy to let his work be. The show opened and closed on the same evening. And it raises questions for the role of participatory art in museum. And I will sort of close this section with the proposition that the LYC Museum was Lee showing us how participatory art could live in a museum setting, where the operational activity of running a museum, the openings, the performances, the programming, publishing, could themselves be considered part of an artwork. It suggests that Lee's engagement with place, a close circle of friends, and distinctive artistic visions played an important role in shaping Lee's imagination of what the LYC Museum could be. In the LYC, Lee had fashioned a machine capable of changing people's relationship with art, with each other, and hence with life. Or as he earlier phrased it, to make fall in love with the world again. Now, the second artwork that I want to focus on, I'll start actually with something from the archive. A book produced with Madeleine Hurkacz, and it documents, it's a photo documentation of Madeleine's stay at a Japanese monastery. And the inside cover has this sort of a trace of ownership from Delia Derbyshire with Madeleine's personal inscription to the LYC library. And Elson and Madeleine, as many of you would have heard yesterday at the performance, in conversation with David Butler, were video pioneers. They met at the Ealing School of Art and Design in 66, became friends and collaborators. Madeleine worked with Elsa at her film and sound studio, and then they were joined later by Delia Derbyshire. They then made two films together, and when Derbyshire moved to Cumbria, they visited their friend at the LYC, met Lee, ended up showing at the LYC Museum, and becoming Lee's friends. The video point in time dates from when Lee visited them in Holland after the LYC closed. It suggests a journey, both physical and internal. The physical one is dominated by footage of a rocky terrain that seems to have been shot from a moving car and then slowed down. It is frequently abstracted. A modulated drone evokes and echoes Highland winds. We see Lee's hands preparing for and performing calligraphy. An ink stick is pressed against a stone mortar and then ground down through steady, rhythmic, circular movements. Minute amounts of water are mixed into the ink to modulate the thickness. Too thick, and the writing will not be fluent. Too thin, and the ink will flow too fast. This is obviously a practiced ritual. We follow these hands, dip a brush into the ink, and describe Chinese characters on paper. The movement is not the dramatic flourish of a heroic drip painting, but more the careful listening of the divining stick, or dowsing rod being manipulated over land to locate a source of water. And as the brush touches the paper, we witness the small oceans of ink from which the calligrapher structures meaning. This is a search. A reading that is lent support by the appearance of an enigmatic compass that frames both the beginning and the end of the work. The movement of the needle from true north to wild gyrations suggest circuitous routes. Point in time encapsulates an exchange of ideas aesthetics, and affective registers, nurtured through years of discussions with Lee, but also with Delia Derbyshire's electronic compositions. It also hints at a shared interest in Buddhism that inflects both practices, those of Lee and Stansfield Huycas. As Dorothea Frank points out, Buddhists are not primarily believers, but practitioners. A section of Frank's text on Stansfield Huycas bears the title Saying What Cannot Be Said, and is an uncanny echo of the title of the survey exhibition of Lee's work, Li Wan Chia, Tell Me What Is Not Yet Said, curated by Guy Brett in the year 2000. Both titles emphasize the unknown, the unsaid, and the unsayable, and suggest the primacy of encounter and feeling as a way to experience the practice of both Li and Stansfield and Huycas. Now, if Huycas Stansfield were friends Li knew, Helen Petz was a friend he didn't. Her film, Space and Freedom, was newly commissioned for Speech Acts and takes its name from Lee's search for the same in Cumbria. It begins in darkness. There are no titles, no images, and a black screen. It heightens our sense of hearing, but despite this preparation, we have to strain to hear a heavily accented male voice whistling and describing a vision for a place. The voice is Li Wan Chia's, and the place is the LYC Museum. These recordings of Li's voice were hiding in plain sight on reel-to-reel tapes in the still-to-be-catalogued LYC archives of the special collections of the John Rylands Library. This is the first time this recording has been digitized, and possibly the first time it has been heard since Li recorded it. Petz uses this sound recording as one of the central pillars of Space and Freedom. She combines it with previously digitized video shot by Li on an 8mm film she shot herself on location, and original music improvised by Steve Beresford. The film thus becomes a site for collaboration across time and with Li and Beresford. A collective exploration of the rhythms, textures, sights, and sounds of the Cumbrian landscape that so inspired Li. Her film has the sensibility of collage, and as a companion piece to throw them up and let them sing. Her poetic film on Kurt Schwitter's exile in Norway, who also ended up in the Cumbrian countryside. Now, the historian Macaulay liked to work on the dead because they stay still and do not answer back. He said, "With the dead, there is no rivalry. In the dead, there is no change. Plato is never sullen. Cervantes is never petulant. Demosthenes never comes unreasonably. Dante never stays too long." But as Petz's film clearly shows us, that the dead can speak to us. But for that, we have to be willing to listen. And I want to end not so much with a conclusion, but a proposition. That there is, in the discipline of art history, an impulse to disentangle entangled histories, to reduce the complex and the messy, to tidy pockets of monographic depth, neat with sharp edges. I would argue for a need for historical research that exceeds national and institutional frames, that is more than singular art historians examining single subjects in single institutions, one object at a time. So undertaking inquiries that are cross-disciplinary, that cross disciplinary and geographic borders requires polyphonic, multi-authored, and speculative approaches that I've described elsewhere as art histories of excess. And in the case of the LYC, we here are a part of two ongoing examples of such collective effort. The first, the exhibition Speech Acts, and the second is this symposium, which is anchored in the exhibition and brings together scholars, artists, museum directors, curators to consider the idea of exhibitions, publications, place, friendship, and the function of museums as a way to think through and think with the LYC Museum and Art Gallery. I'm going to flip through this because hopefully you would have all seen this upstairs. But I wanted the last word to be Lee's. So this is the statement that was in the children's art room of the LYC museum, and we've reproduced upstairs, and it reads, everyone can draw. You can write a poem or draw a picture or write a story with the picture, put it up on the wall or take it with you, or leave it neatly on the table. Enjoy yourself, but don't waste paper. The paper is free. Please leave the table tidy. Thank you. So I'm told we have about 5 minutes for any burning questions. Okay, tepid questions. Thank you, Helen. Ming?
Hamad, thank you so much for this paper. I think it's methodologically really provocative and an important way of rethinking the way that we write art histories. My question is actually a little bit more banal, unfortunately, than your wonderful paper. I'm curious, to what extent was calligraphy a part of Lee's practice? Because it seems to be quite different from many of the works that we've seen in your exhibition, but also in other exhibitions. I'm wondering what role that played in his work.
Far from being banal, I think that's a great question that I feel not completely equipped to answer, if I'm honest. I think there's still considerable work to do, and I think one of the things that we might do is hold this question and point it to Leslie Ma a little bit later, but there's copious amounts of calligraphy within the archive. He was a poet. He's a poet, not just in Chinese but in Italian and English. That also says something about his spirit. And as you would have seen in Madeleine's wonderful film, there is muscle memory. Watching him perform calligraphy. So it was very much part of, I think, his vocabulary, but how it has been historicized, displayed, and understood within part of his wider practice, I think remains a question. Charles?
Did we know about who went to the museum? Was it this group of people that are in Cumbria at the time? Was it local people? Was it people that got the train from London, or I guess from London,
The short answer is all of the above. I think and Kate Jessen, who curates the exhibition with me and has been leading people from all sorts, from everywhere through the exhibition, I think has been building up a little informal database of personal stories and anecdotes. But the sheer number of artists, designers, creative people who experience the museum as a child is sort of fascinating. And one of the things that is currently being looked at is the possibility to think of effect that the exposure to the museum had, long-term effect in sort of changing people's lives. I think one of the best stories that Kate shared with me, and I forget who it was who said, but it was somebody who went to the LYC Museum as a young girl and then described their shock when they found out that not every city has one. And we have within our audience Joy D, who assisted Lee at the museum, and Nick Sawyer, of course, who brought Lee to Cumbria. So hopefully there will be time to table some of these. Ah, Joy, please.
Gallery and Northern Newcastle and Durham, and he was known and loved, and people went out there from the Northeast. And Northern Ireland was very active in those days, very, very lot going on. And so, you know, all those people were drawn into LYC. And it was like, I mean, we lived in Sunderland at the time, and we would go out there with our kids for a Saturday opening. And it was just one of the highlights of the month, you know. And he had, of course, four new exhibitions every month. Mm-hmm. No matter what time of year, always open. Nowhere else like it, I tell you.
No, not at all. Yeah, it's a perfect example of the collaborative work of the symposium. Well, I think we will have the rest of the day for questions. With that, thank you and encourage our first session.